Empire, it's lovely to have your company. It's been 3 years since the murders of Brisbane mother Hannah Clarke and her three children. And today in Queensland, Hannah's law became one step closer to reality. The state is now on track to legislate against coercive control, a type of domestic abuse that can involve manipulation and intimidation. Georgina Hill caught up with Hannah's parents about what today means to them.
Well, this is a major step forward in Queensland's fight against family and domestic violence, with legislation for coercive control, the first stage, passing Parliament. And two people who have been at the forefront of this fight are Sue and Lloyd Clarke, and they join me now. Sue and Lloyd, thank you as always for your time. This has been a fight that you started pretty much on day one, 3 years ago. How does it make you feel today that there is some action and these steps are taking place?
Very emotional, very proud. We asked the government to listen, and they did. And they've listened to all the other advocates, and they've followed through.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, no one wants these laws quicker than our family. But I think it's a small step that they're taking. That needs to be taken, and we're heading in the right direction, definitely.
We didn't know the words coercive control before your story. Now that there's something that is spoken about and there's that education coming through, how important is that?
I think it's very important that everyone understands what coercive control is, and they can see the red flags in their own relationships or friend or family's relationships. Be there to point it out, have a quiet word, or even call out a perpetrator if you know one.
It's a very hard and complex matter, so that's why we need a lot of education, so people can understand it better, can, like Sue said, see the red flags and actually do something about it. We need to all be vigilant, and if we see someone that's not behaving properly, actually have a word to them and say, hey, that's not cool. Let's do something about that. Let's sit down and have a coffee. Let's have a chat. We all need to have these conversations about coercive control.
This really lays the foundations to make coercive control a standalone offence. That's something Sue and Lloyd Clarke hope will happen by the end of the year.
Georgina Hill there. Embattled national carrier Qantas has announced a record $1 billion half-year profit 12 months after posting a $1.3 billion underlying loss before tax for the same time last year. CEO Alan Joyce confirmed the airline is back in the black after losses totalling $7 billion due to 3 years of the COVID pandemic. Strong travel demand, particularly in the leisure sector, has been credited for the turnaround, along with higher airfares and cost cutting.
Well, interest rates and inflation are expected to hit discretionary spending at some point. We've yet to see any signs of that in our bookings, in our forward bookings. In fact, the research shows that travel is one area that people want to prioritise over the next 12 months.
A $500 million share buyback scheme will return money to shareholders, while 20,000 non-executive staff are on track to receive up to 1,000 Qantas shares. Mr. Joyce says the cost of airfares will continue trending down. Tech giants Twitter, TikTok and Google and the gaming platforms Twitch and Discord have been issued legal notices by Australia's eSafety Commissioner in order to reveal what they are doing to combat online child exploitation. eSafety Commissioner Julie Inman-Grant joins us now. Commissioner, thank you for joining us on Midday. How long do the companies have to respond?
Well, the companies have 35 days to respond, up from 28 days, because not only are we asking them about what they're doing to combat child sexual abuse material, we're asking about what they're doing to combat sexual extortion, targeting young men, and what they are doing to prevent their algorithms from amplifying seriously harmful and illegal content. If they do not answer truthfully comprehensively, then we can fine them up to $700,000.
So are you going to be fact-checking their response?
Well, we've done, of course, a tremendous amount of research, and the Online Safety Act does guide that we have to put together a very comprehensive set statement of reasons as to why we're targeting these. Of course, we take in reports of sexual extortion and child sexual abuse material every day, so that gives us a very solid evidence base. And how these different companies companies have addressed these issues in the past, and the safety deficiencies that we have found have definitely been part of this.
How widespread is child exploitation material on these platforms?
Well, it's rife and it's found out in the open. And we traditionally talk about child sexual exploitation just being on the dark web. In an investigation that eSafety and the Canadian Centre for Child Protection did in 2020, we found literally hundreds of thousands of links to child sexual abuse material on Twitter. We know from talking to some of the other platforms that it is a challenge. It's like an arms race, but they've got the resources, they've got access to advanced technology and the smartest minds. We want them to put that innovation and investment towards creating safer platforms. Just think about the incalculable harm that this causes survivors. This follows people who have experienced child sexual abuse their entire lives. And every time it's posted and shared, it increases that re-traumatization.
Commissioner, these companies repeatedly say they have a zero tolerance policy, but their own algorithms are recommending sexualized content. So how do they reconcile both of those?
Well, again, I think talk is cheap. You can say it's your top priority and it's abhorrent, but you really have to put your money where your mouth is, and there's lots of money there. So we're waiting for them to show us precisely what they're doing, what technologies they're using. There are free technologies that have been available for almost 10 years, actually more than 10 years, photo DNA. It's used in a privacy-preserving way, and it also has a 1 in 50 billion false positive rate. So it's very, very accurate. 200 companies we know are already using this technology. So we should expect these mainstream platforms that our children are on every day to take those basic steps.
So, Commissioner, you've issued these legal notices, but this comes off the back of issuing other legal notices to tech giants like Apple, Meta and Microsoft last year. What impact did those notices have?
Well, they've actually had some significant impact. So, for instance, I was able to meet with senior level executives at Microsoft in January, and they were very surprised with what we turned up. And these executives said, we're going to double down. We're going to take this seriously. We're going to send some more top executives out to Australia to speak with you and see how we can work on this and do better. I met with the global heads of public policy this week from Discord and TikTok, and they were very accepting that these notices were coming, and they said, hey, this is a hard issue. We know it's a problem. We want to do better. We'll tell you what we're doing now, and we tell you what we're planning to do. And this is what we're trying to seek. We're trying to illuminate the real scale and scope of the problem, but also to highlight industry best practice and lift safety standards over time. And this is what our industry codes will also help us enforce.
Well, eSafety Commissioner Julie Inman-Grant, thank you for joining us at Midday. To report online abuse or for more information on staying safe online, go to esafety.gov.au. Foreign Minister Penny Wong has confirmed the deaths of two Australian men in a light plane crash in the Philippines. Karthi Santhanam and Simon Chipperfield from Adelaide were working in the area as consultants for Energy Development Corp when their plane came down in bad weather, 350 metres from a volcano crater in central Philippines. Search and rescue teams reached the plane overnight and confirmed there were no survivors. A Sydney man killed by a shark in New Caledonia has been identified. Chris Davis was holidaying with his family when he was fatally attacked by a suspected 4-metre tiger shark. The 59-year-old husband and father of three was swimming near a pontoon at Chateau Royal Beach in Noumea when the shark bit him several times. Two nearby jet skiers pulled Mr Davis to shore, however, he died shortly after. This is the third attack on this beach within 3 weeks. Locals have since posted on social media pictures showing the suspected shark had been caught. Upon its election, the federal government vowed to bring the care back into aged care. From July, mandatory 24/7 nursing requirements will come into force. Now, with just a few months to go, providers are raising their concerns. Political reporter Stella Todorovic has been investigating.
Nerolda, there are genuine fears within the sector that there will be mass closures of aged care centres across the country, especially in regional and rural parts of Australia. Tonight, we sit down with one provider who says she can't see her 19-bed nursing home surviving beyond next year if she has to bring in those 24/7 nurses and meet those care minutes by October. That's even if she gets a year-long exemption from the federal government, and that's because the nurses are simply nowhere to be found. Our special report will air tonight at 5 o'clock.
Selton Horovitz there. Now for some good news. 29 Aussie animals have been pulled back from the brink of extinction. 15 mammals, 4 frogs, 8 birds, 1 reptile and a fish no longer meet the criteria for being threatened in research published by the Journal of Biological Conservation. Some of the notable animals include the humpback whale, the Murray cod, the Goldian finch and the yellow-footed rock wallaby. However, scientists are reminding the public these animals represent less than 10% of Australia's threatened species, with many more in need of saving.